Now, I presume we already started with a business meet. Just a small background I'll give. I'm entrepreneur as well as an academician. I did a lot of businesses earlier. Did pumping machinery contracts, ran a workshop for 15 years, and water treatment equipments, manufacturing and design, and all those kind of stuff, apart from teaching in an engineering institute. So that helped me academics and bridging with this. But then I realized manufacturing kind of stuff is not my baby. My brain works better in innovation and R&D kind of thing. So I just stopped those activities and focused here. I have a lot of patents in different areas. But meeting Deepak by chance was one milestone, I'll say. It just got me focused exactly what to do and how to do. As an enthusiast, I used to go everywhere to give lectures. And then it started happening. I used to think if I go to some institute, some engineering college, I give lectures, I talk to the management, and then something will happen. They will also say, okay, let us put up a solar system, cooking system, or let us put up biogas system. Some people will get interested. It wasn't happening actually. Most of the time, the paperwork will be completed. Some speaker has come, delivered a special lecture, and that's all. Some people will get impressed for a few hours, maybe 2, 3 days. Still, it goes down. And then I started realizing this model of promotion is really not working. So I just started changing it, and we started into entrepreneurship workshops. Let people do entrepreneurship because he earns his bread and butter. His effort of promoting will be more than mine because I'm lecturing and he is trying to earn something out of it. And then we started getting into the entrepreneurship workshops. Some of my trainees are here also. And I think I just saw the MNR released yesterday. I found more than 60% of the dish manufacturers have been trained by us sometime or other. And in a Schaeffler also, I think a lot of people, even though they were manufacturing, but we trained their staff for installation and commissioning and O&M issues. Entrepreneurship, or basically I'm talking of a promotion, but the best way is to go through entrepreneurship route because they are the one who make more effort to make money and to run their families than the people like us, which will be only delivering lectures now. So there are two aspects. One, in a renewable energy segment itself, manufacturing solar cookers, biogas plant, wood stoves, and energy efficient systems, that is one aspect. If people are willing to get into those kind of entrepreneurship, we are open. We provide all those kind of trainings. And we have a lot of models developed by our own, but there are a lot of technologies which are open source also. And the second aspect is on the user side. The technologies are there. The users, prospective users are there, but the marriage is not happening. And the communication gap is huge. I noticed this. I was consulting to Ministry of New and Renewable Energy for 1 year for promotion of CST, and then I strongly realized how the link breaks. And it's primarily the communication gap, and that is what I'm trying to bridge here. So I'm here talking more about how we use solar thermal technologies, and especially for the people who are interested in adopting or trying to be a bridge between the technology and the user. So these are what can be done by using solar technology. See, a common perception still stops solar thermal at water heating systems. So water heating system will stop at 80 degrees temperature. So anything above that, people do not think solar is worthwhile of thinking. But I can assure you, 300 degrees and above, up to 300 degrees, we have technical solutions. For a businessman, technical solution makes a smaller sense. Bigger is the what is the money matters. So if you look at the spectrum, Shirish made my job a bit easier in the earlier session. He has given you the spectrum where we can use technologies. But for apart from community cooking, in process it, if you see what are the spectrum, dairy, hotel, hospital, textile, pharmaceutical, chemical, metal treatment, food processing industry. Food processing is really one industry and pharmaceutical is other, where solar suits most for two reasons, because of the cleanliness it requires. Like if you are using a drying system, air drying system, then you need really clean air because you are dealing with food, you are dealing with pharma, medicines. So if they are running a boiler, say on some fuel, they cannot put the fluid into the system, so they will have to have a secondary air heat exchangers, put clean air into the system. Solar will generate straight away the clean air and not the intermediaries. So there are some very typical sectors where you need clean heating, solar suits most. And with the technological advancements, we have systems up to 300 degrees. I had a very close interaction with almost all manufacturers during my consultancy tenure, and many users, evaluated many successful and failure projects, and that analysis I'm trying to put in, how we can really promote, how we can learn from those failures, and how we can get into the right slot. So I'm just giving you a small overview of technologies and then come to the financials. Concentrating systems, why we should promote, the main reason is they can replace your oil requirement, industrial oil requirement. Industrial oil requirements are normally your LSD or furnace oil and LPG. So these are the industrial liquid and gaseous fuel, which we almost import almost everything, more than 80%. So a lot of our foreign exchange goes into this, and it makes sense for us as a nation and for the government to promote CSTs, which replaces your oil-based system. So what are the options? Schaefflers, a lot has been talked, many projects. I must tell you, 10 years back, concentrators mean Schaeffler. That was the only equation in India, because that was the technology which was brought by Deepak Bhai, and that was how it's promoted. But now we have many, many options. And to be very frank, like for more than 2-3 dishes for direct cooking, if there are systems for generating steam and thermic fluid, nowadays I won't recommend Schaefflers. Because the alternative technologies have taken up and they are in a better shape now. So the strength of this technology is direct cooking, that is what we recommend, where we recommend Schaefflers. And it is a fixed focus technology, so you don't have a rotating focus, so plumbing and all is easy. It's a fixed focus kind of system. Reasonably old, tested, both ways for its success stories as well as failure stories. And we know why they failed and we know why they succeeded. Weaknesses, a lot of them, but the major ones are the size, because it has a lower aperture available, you normally end up with the bigger systems. Second, you have a size limitation. Now we have many systems from the domestic 2.5 square meter, not many people manufacturing, but on an industrial scale, common is 16, and Mount Abu, they have 60, but not on an industrial scale for some power application. So if we are stabilizing around 16 square meter, then for any sizable installation, you need a large battery of concentrators. Like you see here, we have more than almost 100 concentrators here, because that was the heat requirement. So you have to put more and more dishes. And then more focus, more synchronization, all those complexities come in. So the user has to have that mindset of accepting it with the complexities. But now we have options where we can have practically a computer control systems. And that's where we are switching over, like try to make it more user friendly. The other option is Arun. Already Dr. Kedare was here, the inventor of the system. I like this system in a way that wholly Indian development and for India development, because solar thermal applications in industries, my belief is we can work only in micro and small industries. We won't be able to put them on mega industries because their requirement is huge, and I have a very limited intensity of solar radiation, 700, 800, 900 watt per square meter. So to trap more energy, I need more and more area. So I was invited as a consultant to the Aditya Birla Group company. It was a blind call, so just come and see our campus and see what we can adopt for the solar. I said, give me some data, I'll come. They said, no, you just come and we'll see what to do. The cement company is such an energy intensive company. I just put the just an energy balance sheet and I told them, you need 3,000 acres of land only to cover your 6 hours of heat generation if you want to go solar. So bigger industries, the energy intensities are so high that solar installations will be very, very big. And so we have to have a focus on micro and small industries. Say Indian, many manufacturers are copycats. We try to copy what happens in Europe and US most of the time. But this is not the requirement of Europe and US. They don't have much of a micro and small industries. They have mostly major, bigger ones. So this is something that we have to do, and that was done in case of Arun. They have bigger dishes, 100 square meter, 160 square meter kind of dishes. The strength, one very high strength I find is very low land footprint. For a dish of 100 square meter or 160 square meter, 160 square meter is, I think, 100 square meter is half of the hall at least, I think, almost half of the hall. So such a big dish, but the land footprint is only 3 meters by 3 meters. So you can use the space below the dish for parking, for storage, and those kind of applications. And they, because of very strong academic background, they really commercialize it very, very well. So the thermal profiling, the testing, I'll say many other concentrators, they are not really tested well. People rely on experience. If you see the Schaeffler manufacturers, I think 90% of them have not really gone through a rigorous scientific testing. I'm not saying from an academic point of view, I'm saying from the system designer point of view, because if I want to extend any performance guarantee to anybody, I have to be very sure what my system is capable of and what it can do and what it cannot do. Then only I can extend the performance guarantees. And most of the failed projects are on that premise, that based on some assumption, presumption, people extended the guarantees, and then they find the system is actually performing only at 20%, 25% of what is committed. So you have to know where your system stands. And something that was really well done in this case. The weakness, only weakness I observe is it's expensive. I'll talk of some more dishes. This is another dish for ATE. Actually, this is my dish. My patent I sold to ATE. Two dishes you can see outside, 1.5 square meter and 4 square meter. For an industrial application, we extend it to 25 square meter. Again, size is big, you can see from the person sitting under the dish. I just want to give you a small glimpse of the feel of if the system really works. Because all the photos and videos, you can see only the systems, water and steam will be circulating inside. So you really don't know how the system works or whether it really works, whether the backup is working and system is only been seen. So what we did is we closed the steam, that the strength is very, very similar to our own systems. We have very, very low auxiliary power for this system. That's another best feature. In only 60 watt, we track the whole system. It's also expensive. That's a weakness, I'll say. And this is a feel I just want to give you. So what we did is we just closed the delivery valve, and this is a pressure relief valve that opened. So just you get a very feel of how aggressive steam can be formed by using a simple solar system. So this is a solar concentrating system, and we just closed down. This was during the very first few trials when we were developing the system. I think this is the alpha dish that was there. Then with some troubleshooting, we had a beta dish, and then the commercial launch of these dishes. So just to give you a feel, next is there are many trough manufacturers. Solar trough is worldwide tested technology for solar power generation. But what we need is not that scale. Again, the scale reduced to suitable for micro and SMEs. So there are a lot of trough manufacturers. There are CLFR manufacturers. I'll just skip. These are all technology options. A megawatt, nothing, not much good to talk about. And some imaging concentrators. Now these are, I'll just scroll through the presentation. I'm getting a card from the front. The community cooking, not much of an interest, but there are a lot of process heating application which have been done now on solar thermal, especially the concentrating systems. Solar cooling system, lot many, but now I think this technology is also in a way dead because solar PV cost have come down such a drastically. So instead of doing a VAM, it makes sense to go vapor compression system rather than VAM. And also VAM requires a backup, which is normally vapor compression. So it's better to shift to vapor compression because we found financially this doesn't make any sense today. Now, vapor absorption machines, which are run on thermal compressors, and vapor compression system, which we run on electrical compressors. Okay, I think the technical part is over. I'm already into a business session, so I think the card, we stop. And here, what the most of the people will be interested in, how the economics of the system works. Now, for different systems, these are the kind of subsidy structures provided by government. I must admit, financial viabilities of these systems are still not there without any subsidy support. But with a government subsidy support, there are excellent financial viabilities. Technology point of view, I agree, but I have not seen any solar CST manufacturer making money out of a business. Many of them made money by some other means, but not doing a genuine solar business. Most of them were more passionate, struggling, but they want to do, they did system. So the overheads in this business are too high. So I think unless until the volumes really go up and the overheads come down, the cost will rationalize. But at present, the overheads are too high. The marketing expenses are too high. You have to reach maybe 100 queries to strike one deal. And then you need to make your marketing people run around, make proposals, submit proposals, and then you say, oh, this is not viable. We don't have fund this time. So the overheads are really very, very high. So once you get that volumes coming in, I think the overheads can be brought down. And then maybe we can get rid of subsidy support. Now, what is existing today? Existing today, the MNRE provides 30% subsidy, subject to benchmark cost. I'll tell you what it is and how it actually affects. The second part is there is a UNDP project going on, UNDP GF project ongoing, which gives additional 20% subsidy. Now, you might see a lot of question marks at the end, why I have put them. Just because the project is going to end in March, and I am not sure if anybody talks to me that I want to do a system, very likely it will be after the March, and I'm not sure whether that subsidy will be extended or will not be extended. So, ISCO mode, when energy service company takes a contract for energy cell, not the system cell, then there is an additional 10%. So they are going to sell only kilocalories and not the system. System will be owned by the ISCO company, energy service company. If that is a business model adopted, then the UNDP says we give you another 10%, because then you are assuring the system performance in a way. Now, there is another opening. There is a UNIDO GEF scheme, and they are working with IREDA, but they are not giving subsidies, but they are giving soft loans at 7%. One can avail either 2 or 3, but I think 2 will close down in March, and there might be an extension or something new may come up. But as on today, we have no indication what is going to happen after March. Then accelerated depreciation. So when you calculate your cash flows and your profitability, you consider tax rebates. Now, accelerated depreciation, 80% is allowed, but there are a lot of news, maybe Jagat Bhai can confirm if they are true, that all these accelerated depreciations will now be restricted to 40% after 1st April. This is available not only for solar thermal, it is all available for all renewable energy technologies plus all energy efficient technologies. So there is likely chance that it will be reduced for 40%. Why I am talking more on this? Because any businessman who want to adopt will like to have a very clear financial picture, what he is going to get, and based on that, he will work on his paybacks and his ecosystem economics, and that is how the financial investment decisions are driven. Now, assessment of a benchmark cost. These all subsidy figures are based on the benchmark cost. There are some technologies where the benchmark cost is rational, but for the technologies like dual axis, they are not rational. The cost is high. And then the government provides a subsidy on the solar component of your system. So if somebody is doing, say, a solar bakery, he will get a subsidy on the solar concentrators, not on a bakery. So if you think of a project, the subsidy gets diluted over a project. And there is another hitch we are fighting with MNRE for 3-4 years now. Their system of subsidy rewards inefficiency. They don't reward efficiency. Like 100 square meter of a click dish will be equivalent to 250 square meter of Schaeffler dishes. 2.5 times more Schaeffler dishes will be required. But the subsidies are given on square meter basis. So Schaeffler dish project person will get almost 2.5 times more subsidy than the click dish. So that's the structure. So we are insisting that we should have a performance-based subsidy and not the square meter-based subsidy or size-based subsidy. Now coming down to project economics, what Ghanshyam Bhai was saying, that people are reluctant because the financials are not good. I'll say the situation is not so. With the subsidy structures in place, reasonably good. Now what you see, there are some statements I am going to make. If you are looking only at the financial part, it does not make sense to talk to the people who are already using coal or biomass. Coal or biomass is such a cheap energy source that with solar replacement, I can't keep my payback less than 8, 9, 10 years. So it just doesn't make sense. If somebody is going to invest only for the investment purpose, keep away from the people who are into biomass and coal. We just can't compete at present. But LPG, LDO, furnace oil. Yes, electricity. If these are the sources of the heat, it definitely makes sense to think on a project, at least to get the financial evaluations done, whether it will be okay to invest or not okay to invest. Now this one picture, I have shown something like paybacks can be less than 2.5 years, but with a caution note, this is for a 100% utilization factor, like 270 days sun available, you are using every hour of sun. Now, if you have holidays, if you have something else, just deduct that factor and that's how your paybacks will go up. So this is the best payback you can get. And then again, in a business meet, I'll share some Excel sheets so that people can play with it if they want and get the realistic scenario, how the system is going to behave. But if I take a case of a steam generation, this is how the system will behave, cost of the steam, this is how it will behave with different fuels and as a with solar. Project made economic sense earlier. When I was a consultant, I developed 12 detailed project reports for different clients. So it was good, it made economic sense with a good payback. Suddenly the oil prices slapped to $30. And the project I was talking of 3 years payback became a 6 year payback and the investor ran away. Now with oil coming back into the scenario, now we again started getting some inquiries, okay, what can be done now? So now I think the scenario is pretty improved. Okay, I think there are some my judgments of analysis of different systems, why projects have failed and what are the challenges, but I think it's better for me to open up it for a discussion and take it in the discussion session. Okay. Small thing. When we make a choice of technology, I'm seeing the role of a consultant, intermediary is missing in a whole system. It's not only about the solar, it's about the application. And there has to be a very good marriage between the solar and the application. Somebody who understands the application well and synchronizes its solar system suitable to the application, then only it is going to work. And that middle role, the consultant has to do well. And that is something which is missing everywhere. So the system which are simple to synchronize are working well. Systems which were complex to synchronize either failed or giving trouble. So just one slide. And the other technologies apart from the concentrators, you can have dryers, you can have distillation systems, you can have industrial ovens. Those are the things. For food processing industry, these are the special incentives, I'll say. And I find this one interesting possibility, like organic food. I talked to Rolf in my visit to Germany once. He took me to a super shop and he said, this gentleman is ready to keep one corner of a super shop only for a solar food with a banner. But we need to get a good source of organic and solar processed food, and that there are people who are ready to pay premium and buy. So such kind of special demand can also be created. Now we know people going to go to organic food shop and purchasing something. They will also go to solar food corner and purchase something from there. So that kind of demand also can be created. Thank you.